Yep. I think I'll just get started. I feel the Lord calling me to give my testimony. In March 2008, I started to translate the King James Bible to Faroese. I live in the Faroe Islands, north of Great Britain and just south of Iceland. It started in 2006 or 7. I was looking at clips on YouTube and I ran across a lady called Gail Riplinger, and she was giving some speeches about perversions in the Bible or with Bible versions. And it led to that I ordered two books, New Age Bible versions, and In Awe of Thy Word. And so in 2007, I read through these books and I saw many, there are many lists in here. Don't know if you can see it. There are lists where she documents differences in the two streams of Bibles. You know, there are two streams of Bibles. It's the Alexandrian stream and the Byzantine stream. And I learned that the King James Bible is the pure, preserved Word of God. God promised in Psalm 12, verse 6 to 7, that He would preserve His words forever. And so, upon reading these two books, the Lord started speaking to my heart almost constantly. You know, I have we have two Bible translations in Faroese. We have two Bibles. One of them is called Biblia, and the other one is called Biblian. And I learned and I saw that they are both, or they are two translations of the wrong text type. They were both made in the first half of the 20th century, and they are entirely, almost entirely based on the Alexandrian text type. You know, the text that Westcott and Hort revived in 1881. And quite frankly, I was heartbroken because I've been a Christian since I was 15. Now I'm 41. And I have always, ever since I was saved, I have loved the Bible, read the Bible daily, had it lying, you know, beside my pillow, even when I sleep, because it is God's voice to me. But I had to be true, and I had to acknowledge that my Bible was full of mistakes. And I went through all the differences that are listed in the book, New Age Bible Versions, and I saw that it was on every page, you know, every column of every page. And I had to recognize that I was sitting with a corrupt Bible. And Gail Riplinger, she also mentions in her book, New Age Bible Versions, that it is not, the King James Bible is not alone, but all the Reformation Bibles through all of Europe were done from the same text type. It was the Masoretic Hebrew Old Testament, called Ben Chaim for the Old Testament, and they used Erasmus's version of the New Testament, of the Textus Receptus, or what is called Robert Stephanus's New Testament. Or Theodore Beza. And And so I acquired also an old Danish Bible from 1732, and this one is set with a Gothic font, you know. I don't know if you can see it. It's maybe a little unclear, but it's set with a Gothic font, and I can read it. You know, it's old language, but I can read it. And also, I got this Luther Bible, Die Heilige Schrift. I got this one sent from Switzerland, from a man named Nico Verhoef, a Bible teacher there. And I saw that the King James and this old Danish Bible and the Luther Bible, they are the same Bible. It's the same book. They're just minor differences, but they're so minor, you know, that they really don't count very much. But I saw that the two translations I have here in Faroese, they cannot even be called the Word of God. And it broke my heart. And the Lord started to pull at my heart. You know, when I was praying, the Lord would say, "Translate the King James Bible." And I didn't dare do it. And the Lord struggled with me for a whole year. And so I started to correct this Bible, which is the Bible of the Lutheran Church. I took the text in and I went through, you know, verse after verse, and I did thousands of changes, thinking that I could repair it. And I did that for a whole year. But I found out that it was impossible, because the differences were found to be even in the forms of the words, the very forms of the words, in syllables of words, there were differences. And it was impossible to get a pure Bible. And then in March of 2008, I suddenly got an email from someone in Denmark that I didn't know even. And they invited me to a Bible conference. It was a conference about Bible translations and street evangelism, which I have been doing a little bit of, street evangelism. And I found out that it was Gail Riplinger who had written to a couple in Denmark who also are working on translating the King James Bible into Danish. And so I went to this conference, and it was this man called Nico Verhoef, a Bible doctor in Switzerland, who was teaching us about the Bible version issue. And there I settled it in my heart. I will translate the King James Bible. And I started right away. This was the 28th of March 2008, and I would translate one page every day. And I made an agreement with the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. I said, "I will get up at 6 o'clock every morning and translate one page from this big Cambridge Pure Edition." Don't know if you can see it. It has only the words of God with big type, big letters. And I would have this sitting in my dock, and I would, you know, the dock just in front of my computer, and I would translate word for word, every word. And when I was 10 years old, my family moved to the Shetland Islands, which is the northernmost part of Great Britain, a group of islands there, where my father was a missionary to Norwegian fishermen. And so we lived there for 5 years, and I learned English, or Scottish English, you know. And when I was 15, I could speak better English than I could speak Faroese. So I know my English quite well. And so translating was not so difficult. And but whenever in doubt of a word, I would use dictionaries and word lists. You know, I acquired some word lists of archaic Bible words. There's a word list given out by David W. Daniels, and I used that, and I also used the Sword of the Lord, a computer program. And quite early on, I would also decide to make a word list in Microsoft Word. I just made an alphabetical list, and whenever I had looked up a word in some dictionary or in the word lists that I had, and when I had settled a word that this was the best word to use in Faroese, then I would type it in my word list. And that word list has now grown to contain 14,200 words in total in that word list. And that has shown to be very useful to use. So that I would only have to look up every word once, and then that was settled. But I would also choose three words for every difficult word, so that I would maybe decide to use one of the words in one verse, and in some other verse I would use another word that would fit better into that verse, you know. Yeah. And by the grace of God, it took 14 months to translate the whole New Testament. I would translate one page every day, and it's a strange thing, you know. I made this agreement with the Holy Spirit that I would get up at 6 o'clock every morning, and some mornings I thought I would sleep in, and I would not set my clock to wake me. But then the Holy Spirit woke me. There would be a loud sound in the room, or I would hear a sound on the computer, a cracking sound, very loud, and I would wake up, and I would put the light on in the room, and the time was 6:02, and I knew that I could not sleep in. I had to do it, so I did it. And then after completing the translation of the New Testament, I proofread it through 10 times before sending it to be printed. 5 times where I would play off, you know, a file on the computer, and I would follow on my translation. I would play one sentence at a time, and then stop, and then another sentence, then stop, and I would do between 10 and 20 pages a day. And then I would proofread through in Faroese, and then again with playing the files. So I did 5 proofreadings of each. And then of course I used spelling control in Microsoft Word to catch spelling errors. And then after proofreading 10 times, it was printed. And So I want to encourage other people in other countries. You know, we cannot only have the pure word of God in English. There are many languages in the world. And if you look a little bit on YouTube and listen to the people who defend the King James Bible, I'm sure you will see that this is a very serious issue. It is a very serious issue for every Christian that he has the pure word of God. It means a lot to me, and I had to do it. And when I had been translating for 3 months, I had just started the book of John. Then the Lord graciously confirmed his calling to me by an audible voice in my sleep, which said, "Thou shalt translate the King James Bible, and your reward will be great." It was just a voice. I had not seen any person, but I had heard the voice. It was very authoritative, very loud, it was very masculine, and it echoed in the room when I woke up. And I felt the voice in my being, in my soul, for many, many months afterwards. And even when I say the words, when I say them myself, I remember it deep in my heart. So the Lord has been very gracious, and so today the New Testament has been printed in the United States by some very gracious, generous brethren over there in North Carolina and in Tennessee and elsewhere, Florida and elsewhere. They have collected the money. It has been Baptist churches over there who have done that, and they have printed. I will be receiving. That's the New Testament. And I will be receiving altogether 29,000 copies of the New Testament. And the Faroe Islands, we are only about 50,000 people, and about 18,000 households. So I am now able to go around the islands, or around all the villages, and put two copies in every postbox of God's pure word. God's pure word. And now I can sit with my copy in the Faroese tongue. Every word is in place. Every critical word has been translated by a word in my language that means exactly the same as the word in the King James Bible. Therefore, I can sit now with the Faroese King James New Testament and it is God's voice to me, and it is pure, it is complete, it does not leak, it holds water. And when translating, you know, I translated not just every word, but every syllable of every word. Sit and think, I mean, how would we say that? Sort of, and then just say it totally differently. No, I translated all the words. And then when proofreading in the Faroese, I would alter, you know, the word order whenever necessary. But the very strange thing is that I found out that the King James, the language of the King James Bible is so simple. It's just so childlike. And I heard that when we speak as simply as we can, and when we hear children speak, they speak just like the King James Bible speaks. So therefore, I just decided that I would just leave most of the sentences just as they are in the King James Bible, only with Faroese words, and you can understand it. You can understand it. Yeah. And I feel now that when I sit in my chair and have a read in the Bible, it makes no difference if I'm reading in the Faroese King James or in the English King James. It feeds my heart. It feeds my spirit. And I can trust it 100%. 100%. You know, I did not... I was not going to let my nation, my people, wait another century for some priest or some scholar or some learned person to do it. No, they are never going to do it. They will never translate the Ben Chaim Old Testament and the Theodore Beza Textus Receptus from 1598. They won't do it. I had to see that. You know, these theologians, these people that speak Hebrew and Greek, they're all following the Alexandrian school of thought. So therefore, I can just recommend to anyone who doesn't have a pure Bible in their language, translate the words of the King James Bible. Translate all of them. And choose words that are so parallel, that contain the same meaning, and that are at the same level of dignity, the same level of the same, smell the same, taste the same, feel the same in your heart, and search for the right words, not only with the dictionaries, but with your heart also. I think it's necessary that you master both English and your language completely. You must master them completely. And I have found also that knowing Icelandic fully, you know, I studied graphic design in Reykjavik, and I lived in Iceland for 3 more years after that also, so I have lived there for 7 years. And Icelandic is an older form of Faroese, and Faroese is maybe a little bit narrow, it's a bit shallow, you know. Sometimes you search for words when you're translating from the King James Bible, but I found that knowing Icelandic, I could borrow, because the languages have the same roots, and 80% of the words are almost identical, you know. And for example, when I moved to Iceland, I had only lived there for about a month, when suddenly, all of a sudden, I could understand everything and speak it fluently. It's just like, you know, French and Italian and Spanish, you know. They have the same roots. If you go back about 7 or 8 centuries, then they become more and more and more similar. It's the same with Icelandic and Faroese. So, and also I found that doing this very thing, you know, borrowing words and expanding the language, I found that it also seasons, it sort of puts salt on the words. It makes it it gives it dignity and makes it special. And there's another thing that I decided to do. I did not want a modern Bible. I mean, there are modern Bibles all over the world, and who cares for them? Who respects them? Who loves them? Who would die for them? Nobody. Nobody. But I would die for my one. I would be burned at the stake for my one. Because I know that it is the words of God, the perfect words of God. How I can know that? Because, well, I have all the words of God here in this book. And I have translated those words. Not thought for thought. No. Word for word. Verb for verb. Adjective for adjective. Pronoun to pronoun. And so on and so forth. Yes. And of course, this causes ridicule. People will call you crazy, and people will call you a fundamentalist. And I say, call me what you will. I love the Word of God, and you can mock all you want. You can kick me, you can kill me, you can chop my head off. You can burn me at the stake. Just remember to tie a copy of my Faroese King James around my neck. And I will gladly go into eternity and meet Jesus and eat steak with Tyndale and Wycliffe and other good men of the faith. It would be my honor. So just give it your best shot. You nincompoop. You popish nincompoop from hell. Well, then after when I had sent the New Testament to be printed, I continued to translate the Old Testament, and then I had, in better training, and I could translate 2 pages a day, and so I translated 2 pages a day for 3 years, and then in March of 2012 I finished translating the Old Testament. I would translate 2 pages, you know, from there down to here, every morning. And you need to be stubborn. You need to be very, very stubborn. And you will never finish if you translate whenever you feel like it. No. You have to get up every morning and not go to bed until you have translated the portion for that day. If you do that, then you suddenly see, wow, I've already translated 500 pages. A couple of months later, wow, I've already translated 800 pages. And then half a year later, wow, I've only got 100 pages left. And then half a year later, you're finished. Hallelujah. Yep. Yes. So I just want to also thank all the people out there on YouTube. I watched a lot of YouTube videos with Brian Denlinger. I watched them all. And Edward 123 and all the other ones, you know, many hours a day. And I want to thank you all because that has encouraged me an awful much, and kept me going, given me added wood to my fire, and kept my fire burning. And so, God bless you all. And praise the Lord, he has preserved his words in the King James Bible. They are pure. And And another thing I want to say, that I want to encourage you all that are defending the King James Bible. I think that you will have great reward in heaven. Great reward in heaven. Yeah. Like the Lord said to me, thou shalt translate the King James Bible, and your reward will be great. Hallelujah. I want to read Psalm 12. Psalm 12, 6 to 7. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord, thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. Praise the Lord. Amen. Yeah. The Bible is a holy book. The word Bible means book, and the King James Bible is called the Holy Bible. It was never called the King James Bible until Satan's perversions started coming along after 1881. It's all Satan's perversions. The Book of God is the King James Bible. And you know, these three pure Bibles that I held up before you, these three, the King James, the Old Danish, and the Luther Bible. You know what they call their New Testament? They say, the New Testament of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The Luther Bible says, Das Neue Testament unseres Herrn und Heilandes, Jesu Christi. And the Old Danish says the same. Det Nye Testament, vår Herre og Frelsers. Yep. And you know what these Alexandrian perversions say? These two? You know what they say? They just say New Testament. As if to say, this is a New Testament. Well, whose is it? Well, I had to come to the conclusion that it's not the New Testament of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And these books are not even holy books. They don't even say that they are holy books. They just say Bible. And in this tract from Gail Ripplinger, It says here that in 2 Peter 1:21, NIV and NASB, they just say men of God. But the King James says holy men of God. And so does Luther, and so does the Old Danish. In Matthew 25:31, King James says holy angels. The Alexandrian Bibles just say angels. In 1 Thessalonians 5:27, the King James says holy brethren. The Alexandrian Bibles just say brethren. That is including both of these Alexandrian Faroese Bibles, not holy Bibles. In Revelation 22:6, the King James says holy prophets. The Alexandrian Bibles just say prophets. In Revelation 18:20, the King James says holy apostles and prophets. The other Bibles just say apostles and prophets. In John 7:39, the King James says Holy Ghost. The Alexandrian perversions just say Spirit. And the same is in 1 Corinthians 2:13, in Matthew 12:31, in Acts 6:3, and in Acts 8:18. So the King James was written by holy men. In King James you have holy angels, and you have holy brethren, you have holy prophets, you have holy apostles and prophets, and you have the Holy Ghost again and again. In the Alexandrian perversions you have just a book, a New Testament written by men, and you have Jesus coming back in Matthew 25 just with angels, not holy angels. And you have just brethren, not holy brethren. You have just prophets, not holy prophets. And you have just Spirit, not Holy Spirit, not the Holy Ghost. So I think these things are very, very telling. They're very telling. They say something about what kind of a book this is. What kind of a book this is. It's not a holy book. They don't claim to have a holy book. And so that's what I've seen. They're not holy books. Here's my translation of the King James. It says, Hitt nudja testamente vors harra og frelsara, Jesu Christs. The New Testament of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And it is written by holy men of God. And it is written, Jesus comes back with holy angels. It is written to holy brethren. And it has holy prophets, and holy apostles and prophets. And it carries with it the Holy Ghost, not just a spirit. What sort of a spirit is that? Well, it's a false spirit. Yeah. That's it. Boy. These are not minor things. If you don't love the Word of God and you call yourself a Christian, I will call you a hypocrite. A hypocrite is what you are, and you will need to repent. About our high priest, we read in Hebrews chapter 7, verse 26. For such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. That is how Jesus is. He is our high priest in heaven. One of his names is the Word of God, with a capital W. That means the manifest Word of God, the Word of God made flesh, God manifest in the flesh. And here we read that he is holy, harmless, undefiled. Undefiled. He's clean, he's pure. And pure means clean all the way through. When we think clean, it's just like cleaned on, clean on the outside. But something that is pure is clean in its very core. That's how Jesus is. And then it says, separate from sinners. So, his word, his New Testament, the New Testament of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, also is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners. That is why, in translating the King James New Testament and the King James Bible, I have separated myself totally from the world's line of thought. This is my only authority, the Word of God. And it shall be untainted of the world, untainted of the world's way of thinking, the world's philosophy, and so on and so forth. And this is a holy book, and it verily is separate from sinners. It is made higher. Made higher than what? Than everything common. It is made higher. The King James translators made it higher. Back in 1611, when it came out, even then it contained things which were out of use and had been out of use for 3 or 4 centuries. The EST endings and the ETH endings, they were not in common use when the King James Bible came out. But they decided to use it to correctly convey the languages of Greek and Hebrew. And so that is why, so the King James Bible, right from its appearing, has been made higher, separate from sinners, separate from everything that's common. This is not a common book, it's a holy book. And I have studied, I have not learned languages in any school, but I have studied etymology, read some books about the subject. I have read the roots of Faroese going back to the old Norn language, also knowing Icelandic. I find this very, very interesting. So I have studied the roots of my native tongue right back to the Gothic. And even reading Gothic, I can see many, many words there that are that come through into the old Norn language, which is the old Viking language. And many of these words we can see in Faroese. Yes, in Faroese and in Icelandic. And like I said before, or in a previous segment, I did not want a modern, another just modern, just another Bible. No. This is the Holy Bible in my language. And so I have done, I have felt it in my heart to do it the same way as the King James translators, to make it pure, separate from sinners. And in so doing, in doing this, I saw many or some archaic grammatical principles that are not in use even in English. So someone who's reading the King James Bible today in 2013, reading the King James Bible, you know, he will read things like this. Example, Revelation 3:20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice, if any man hear my voice, why is it not if any man heareth my voice? Oh, because it's in another gear. It is not in a, it is like we're thinking something, because it is, the sentence starts with if any man hear, if. So it's not necessarily, we're not saying fact, we're presuming something, presuming in our mind. And when I started to read the King James back in 2006, you know, I came back from Iceland in 2003, and I was reading this old English language, and I thought, that's just like Icelandic. They would say, ef nokkur maður heyri, and it's just the same, you know, we're just supposing something. And this is not in regular use in Faroese, but it is in Icelandic. And Icelandic is an older form, a more preserved form of the old form of language, which my native language of Faroese comes from, you see. And I decided to use this. I just borrowed it from the Icelandic, put it into my translation of the King James. I don't know what this is called in grammar learning, but I understand how it works. I feel it in my spirit, I feel it in my heart. So I use this all the way through. All the way through. So when reading the Faroese King James New Testament, so ye stand vi dit na du bent jupa. Nekar mevur høyri rödd muina. Yeah. And why I do this? Oh, I'm lifting the word of God up. And people can laugh and ridicule. Oh, they can stand on their head. They can do anything they want. I don't care. I said, I do not care. I only care for the book, the word of God, that it be pure, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher. Made higher. And it is made higher. And the strange thing is that people have read the New Testament through, and they understand it perfectly. I mean, an English-speaking person lifting up this 400 years old book here, he will read many words and he will be confronted with the same archaic grammatical principles, you know, and he has to learn them. And so the English person, He has to do that too. So why not just let the Faroese person do the same? It's no problem. It's no problem. And it reminds the reader that this is not a common thing. It's not a common thing. He can't read the daily newspaper and then just afterwards pick up the New Testament and it just read the same way and it's just the Word of God. No. You must feel and be reminded in every verse, oh, this is something different. This is different. What's this? Oh, this is the Word of God. Pure, holy, undefiled, made higher. Made higher. Amen? It's right to do this. And so it also puts a difference. It separates the scoffer of the Word of God from the lover of the Word of God. And I find that good and proper to do. So let's just see who's the scoffer, and let's see clearly who is the lover of the Word of God, and let there be just a separation between the two. They have nothing in common, neither in this life, and certainly not in the life to come. So the person who lifts up this holy book and starts to read it, he must still his heart, and he must lower his pride, he must humble himself, and he must listen to the voice of God, which is contained in it. Yes, many laugh, many scoff, but I also see more and more many love it, many cherish it. Many even sleep with it on their chest. Yes, many do. The Holy Spirit lives in the Word of God. He does. This is the New Testament of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's not a common thing. Not a common thing. No. Neither is the translation of it. Not a common thing. Amen. There was another thing that the Lord gave me I know that, you know, the most of the people that I have come across in relation to working with the Word of God, most of the people who write the books in defense of the King James Bible, and also the people who have graciously helped me to get my translation printed, most of them, or all of them, are independent Baptists whom I respect and love and admire very much. I must say that I have never seen Christians with so much of unselfish love and pure love for the Word of God, and with such generosity. I am not a Baptist myself. I have a Lutheran background. But in my walk with Christ, I have sought the baptism in the Holy Spirit, and Christ has given this to me, where I speak with tongues and know the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and have many times also prayed for the sick and seen God heal them, and know the gifts of the Spirit. I get words of knowledge. And when I pray and seek God, my hands will burn, and I will lay hands on the sick, and God has healed them, as He wills. It is as He wills. Like it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, that the Spirit, it is as He will, as he will. I will find it for you. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Speaking about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. Yeah. So I know these things, and but they must be balanced with the fruit of the Spirit. That is why I believe this is the reason why Paul was led to write 1 Corinthians 12, speaking about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Then comes 1 Corinthians 13, the chapter of love, the chapter of charity. And then he comes again to the gifts, how they rightly are to be practiced in the church. Yes. All this just introductory to the point that I wanted to come to. That is that just when I was finishing my study in Reykjavik, Iceland in 1997, twice there came two men, an older gentleman and a younger gentleman, came for a week's visit at the Siemens home, a Christian Siemens home, Faroese Siemens home that I stayed at all the 4 years when I was studying over there. And these men were Christians, and they had a prophetic ministry. Prophetic. They came and they said they were sent by God. They were sent to warn the Icelandic government of impending dangers ahead, financial and otherwise. And they came twice. They stayed for a week and they were just up in their room, fasting and praying all the time. They said that they would only sleep 2 or 3 hours a night, and they would seek God in prayer and fasting. And God would show them by vision or by his voice what he wanted them to tell the Icelandic government. And the first time they came, God had given them a sign, and God had said, here's a sign that you are sent from the Lord God Almighty. The day that you leave Iceland, there will be an earthquake. And they left on a Friday, and that day there was a major earthquake. So, but I didn't see much to these men. But the second time they came, the night before they were to leave, the older gentleman came over to me and said, he had understood that I was a Christian, and he said, I was praying for you, and God told me some things to tell you. And so he told me some things that God had been using me for a time, and he saw that God would sort of put me on the shelf for a couple of years, which also happened. I was put on the shelf for some reason for 6 years, and I was just about to burst, you know, desperate. And then he said, the Lord will take you back again and use you again. And then he said something back in March or April or May of 1997, in the spring, he said, I even see some Bible translation. I totally wrote this off. I didn't accept it. I thought the man was a fake, quite frankly. I didn't trust it because I thought, well, I might help someone proofread or might work in a team or whatever, but I could never translate the Bible. I don't speak Greek and Hebrew, so I could never do such a thing. And so this was just sort of something that happened. It was just, I forgot about it. I didn't think about it. Not even when God called me to translate the Bible. I never thought about that incident because it sort of just vanished. I thought, well, that was a mistake. That will never happen. But about 2 or 3 weeks after I had finished translating the whole Bible, I was sitting in my chair here, and I suddenly remembered that man from America sent to Iceland in 97, he said he saw Bible translation. And suddenly, you know, it all came back to me. I even see some Bible translation. Yes. Yes. If God truly calls you, He will equip you, He will keep you, and He knows what you need. You can never just call yourself and say, oh, I will do this or I will do that. I will be a missionary to the Himalayas or anything. But if God truly calls you, He will give you exactly what you need so that you can walk. Of course, by faith, of course, by faith. But it says about Moses that he walked as though he saw the invisible, him as though seeing him who is invisible. Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11. Yes. Hebrews 11, I can't find it right now, the right verse, but it says about Moses. Yes. From verse 24, by faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he had recompense unto the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. As seeing him who is invisible. Of course, God is invisible. But with our eye of faith, we still follow him. I have never physically seen Jesus, although I have seen visions of him. I have seen visions of him, yes. A couple of times. But it's not that is sustaining me. The Word of God sustains me. And it is the light for my path. Yes. It is the light on my path that I walk by, the Word of God. And so I just wanted to share this testimony also, that God even sent those two prophets there, and you know, he knew ahead of time 15 years before it would happen. Some old man said, I even see some Bible translation, and I didn't remember it until afterwards. And the strange thing, I remembered it just at a time where I was very pressed down resistance from people, and also spiritually, and just downcast, you know. But when I remembered this, it lifted me up again. Hallelujah. So all honor to Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Son of God, my Savior and my King and my God. Amen.